نوروا قلوبكم ذكر الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا شفا حفرة من النار وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون ولتكن منكم يدعون إلى الخير يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر ولا تكونوا كالذين تفرقوا واختلفوا من بعد صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
نوروا مجالسكم بذكر الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد. محمد وآل محمد وآل. Many thanks for that beautiful recitation of the holy verses of the Quran by our dear brother Muhammad Mahdi al-Mudhaffar. Inshallah, he'll be reciting Ziyarat Ashura for us as well very, very shortly. Brothers and sisters, before we start the majlis, what's happening every night is that we need to disturb our brother Ibrahim Ansari on the minbar to make sure that everyone can stand up and come as close to the member as possible. So to avoid that happening, inshallah, what I'd like to do to start with, on the brothers and the sisters side, in particular the brothers who are on the top right, or my top right, your bottom left of the majlis near the entrance, inshallah, if you could all get up if you can, and come as close to the member as possible. Rahmallahu man dhakar al-qa'ima min ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. A reminder that when Al-Qa'im is Madhkur, please, if you could stand for the brothers in the back, please, Jazakumullah, to make the majlis easy for us, the brothers who are sitting at the back, if you could stand up and come a little bit closer, and the sisters as well, if you can, as close as possible, to make sure that during the majlis, we do not have to disturb our dear brother Ibrahim Ansari, Jazakumullah, khair al-jaza. Please welcome our dear brother Muhammad Mahdi to recite Ziyarat Ashura with the loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Azuru Sayyidi wa Mawlai Mu'tamadi ورجائي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين وابن سيد الوصين السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة سيدة نساء العالمين السلام عليك يا أثر الله وابن فاطمة وترى الموتور السلام عليك وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار يا أبا عبد الله لقد عظمت الرزية وجلت وعظمت المصيبة بك علينا وعلى جميع أهل الإسلام وجلت وعظمت مصيبتك في السماوات على جميع أهل السماوات فلعل الله أمتان أسست أساس الظلم والجور عليكم أهل البيت ولعل الله أمة دفعتكم عن مقامكم وزالتكم عن مراتبكم التي رتبكم الله فيها ولعل الله أمة قتلتكم ولعن الله الممهدين لهم بالتمكين من قتالكم برئت إلى الله وإليكم منهم ومن أشياعهم وأتباعهم وأوليائهم يا أبا عبد الله إني سلم لمن سالمكم وحرب لمن حاربكم إلى يوم القيامة ولعن الله آل زياد وآل مروان ولعن الله بني أمية قاطبا ولعن الله ابن مرجانا ولعن الله عمر بن سعد ولعن الله شمرا ولعن الله أمة أسرجت وأرجمت وتنقبت لقتالك بأبي أنت وأمي لقد عظم مصابي بك فأسأل الله الذي أكرم مقامك وأكرمني بك أن يرزقني طلب ذلك مع إمام منصور من أهل بيت محمد صلى الله عليه وآله اللهم اجعلني عندك وجيها بالحسين عليه السلام في الدنيا والآخرة يا أبا عبد الله إني أتقرب إلى الله وإلى رسوله وإلى أمير المؤمنين وإلى فاطمة وإلى الحسن وإليك بموالاتك وبالبراءة ممن قاتلك ونصب لك الحرب وبالبراءة ممن أسس أساس الظلم والجور عليكم وأبرأ إلى الله وإلى رسوله ممن أسس أساس ذلك وبنى عليه بنيانا وجرى في ظلمه وجوره عليكم وعلى أشياعكم برئت وتقرب إلى الله ثم إليكم بموالاتكم وموالات وليكم وبالبراءة من أعدائكم والناصبين لكم الحار والناصبين لكم الحار وبالبراءة والناصبين لكم الحرب والناصبين لكم الحرب وبالبراءة من أشياعهم وأتباعهم جميعا إني سلم لمن سلم وحرب لمن حاربكم وولي لمن وعدو لمن عاداكم فأسأل الله الذي أكرمني بمعرفتكم ومعرفة أوليائكم ورزقني البراءة من أعدائكم أن يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة وأن يثبتني عندكم قدم صدق في الدنيا والآخرة وأسأله أن يبلغني المقام المحمود لكم عند الله وأن يرزقني طلب ثاري مع إمام هدى ظاهر ناطق بالحق منكم وأسأل الله بحقكم وبالشأن الذي لكم عنده أن يعطيني بمصابي بكم أفضل ما يعطي مصابا بمصيبة مصيبة ما أعظمها وأعظم رزيتها في الإسلام وفي جميع السماوات والأرض اللهم اجعلني في مقامي هذا ممن تناله منك صلوات ورحمة ومغفرة اللهم اجعل محياي محيا محمد وآل محمد ومماتي ممات محمد وآل محمد اللهم إن هذا يوم تبركت به بنو أمية اللهم إن هذا يوم تبركت به بنو أمية وابن آكلة الأكباد اللعين ابن اللعين على لسانك ولسان نبيك صلى الله عليه وآله في كل موطن وموقف وقف فيه نبيك صلى الله عليه وآله اللهم لعن أبا سفيان ومعاوية ويزيد بن معاوية عليهم منك اللعنة أبد الآبدين وهذا يوم بقتلهم الحسين صلوات الله عليه. اللهم فضاعف عليهم اللعن منك والعذاب الأليم. اللهم إني أتقرب إليك في هذا اليوم وفي موقفي هذا وأيام حياتي. بالبراءة منهم واللعنة عليهم وبالموالاة لنبيك ولنبيك عليه وعليهم السلام. اللهم لعن أول ظالم ظلم حق محمد وآل محمد وآخر تابع له على ذلك. اللهم لعن العصابة التي جاهدت الحسين وشايعت وبايعت وتابعت على قتله. اللهم لعنهم جميعا جميعا. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك، عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعل الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم جميعا. السلام على وعلى علي بن وعلى أولاد وعلى اللهم خص أنت أول ظالم باللعن مني وابدأ به أولا ثم لعن الثاني والثالث والرابع. اللهم لعن يزيد خامسا ولعن عبيد الله بن زياد وابن مرجانا وعمر بن سعد وشمرا وآل أبي سفيان وآل زياد وآل مروان إلى يوم القيامة. سجود. اللهم لك الحمد حمد الشاكرين لك على مصابهم. الحمد لله على عظيم رزيتي. اللهم ارزقني شفاعة الحسين يوم الورود وثبت لي قدم صدق عندك مع الحسين وأصحاب الحسين الذين بذلوا مواجههم دون الحسين عليه السلام.
أحسنت طيب الله أنفاسك. عظم الله أجركم جميعا. Brothers and sisters, if I could please, before we start, as you can see, the hall is already getting quite packed out. So inshallah, we want to make space for the brothers and sisters that will be arriving. For the brothers who are sitting to my right, in front of me to the left, this area needs to be filled, please, as close to the member as you can. For the sisters, please, if you can come forward, just be mindful that there's a cameraman that needs to access through the gap in those chairs. So if I could please ask you all to stand and take a couple of steps forward. Rahamallahu man dhakara al-qa'ima min ali Muhammad. Allah. Please come forward as far forward as you can, brothers and sisters. Jazakum Allah. Be mindful that we want to make as much space as possible. You can find a spot towards the right-hand side for the brothers. There's space next to the minbar as well. Jazakum Allah. A reminder to the younger brothers who are sitting at the front of the majlis, and also for the older brothers who are sitting near the front, please ensure at all times that you're as quiet as possible. You're directly in front of our brother Ibrahim. So if he's doing the masaib or giving a lecture, we want to make sure that you don't distract him. So for the older brothers, if you can see or you around you there's any talking, please be mindful and just make sure that you can sit in between them, inshallah. A reminder as well to the brothers and sisters at the front registration desks, there is donation card machines available. You can also donate in cash. And there's also information about our upcoming Arba'in tour, inshallah, where we'll be joined by Sheikh Azhar Nasser. For those of you that know him, for those of you that not, feel free to search up his majalis and lectures on YouTube. We're also going to be joined by Haraka's own Haj Mustafa Mas'ud, Mulla Ali Fadhil, and of course, Mulla Rashid Haidar. A reminder for telephones, please, 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 to be put on silent. And inshallah, on the sister's side, just from the cameraman a request, just a line, an empty line, inshallah, so our brother can enter and exit, just to make sure that the camera is working during the majlis. Jazakum Allah khair al-jaza. Without further ado, it's my honor to welcome back our dear brother Ibrahim. Tonight's topic is our role in raising the youth, which applies to all of us, young and old. So inshallah, should be an interesting topic for us to listen to. If you could please welcome him with the first of salawats in remembrance of Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam and his brother Imam Hassan Al-Mushtaba, Sayyiday Shabab Ahl al-Jannah. Salla ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. In remembrance of the lady of tonight who we will remember, Ummul Baneen alayhi salam, the mother of the four lions, please, a second salawat. Muhammad. And as always, a third and final salawat to hasten the reappearance of our 12th and awaited savior, Imam Al-Hujjah Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajah Al-Sharif. Salla ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Sallu ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. A second salawat for the love of Imam Al-Hassan and Hussein. And the third and final salawat for the love of Fatima to Zahra with the loudest of your voices. Tonight we are remembering the night of Ummul Baneen, and she is Babul Hawa'ij, a gateway to our needs. So inshallah, when we are remembering any of those infallibles with a salawat, it should be much higher than that, especially for those who are in need and have needs, and we are all those who have needs, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك وعلى آل بيتك الطاهرين ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ إلى حصنكم سادتي سيدي يا أبا عبد الله يا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة ويا باب نجاة الأمة غريب يا مظلوم كربلاء بأبي وأمي من ذبح من القفا بأبي وأمي من ذبح عطشانا يا ابن شبيب إن يوم الحسين أقرح جفوننا يا ابن شبيب إن جدي الحسين قتل عطشانا غريب تركوه في العرى دامي الجسم سليب يا ابن شبيب إن يوم الحسين أقرح جفوننا أسبل أدموا عنها أذل عزيزنا سيدي يا أبا عبد الله يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأمر أهلك بالصلاة واصطبر عليها صدق الله العلي العظيم. Enlighten your majalis and bless this gathering with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Yesterday, we spoke about the topic of truthfulness and trust. We looked at the importance of having these two qualities, given that these two qualities were the qualities that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam possessed even before his ba'tha as a prophet, before he was sent as a prophet. He had those two characteristics. Then we saw how Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib did not reach the status that he reached with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, except through those two characteristics, truthfulness and trust. And then we saw that Imam al-Sadiq said, in fact, that there isn't a single prophet that was sent to their nation except with truthfulness in speech and trust in their action. And therefore, we concluded that of the main signs of a believer is truthfulness and trust. And then we looked at the narration of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, where he said, do not look at the length of the ruku' and sujood of a man, for this is something that he has become used to. Rather, look at the truthfulness in when they speak and their trust in action. And we said that they both come from one root, and that root is that truthfulness is nothing but trustworthiness in speech, and trustworthiness is nothing but truthfulness in action. Tonight, we'll be discussing the topic of our role in raising the youth, in upbringing, in tarbiyah. And this is one of those types of topics that are very important in the sense that when we talk about youth in general, we are talking about a future generation. We are not just talking about children who are going to grow up. No, we are talking about the future generation in all of its aspects, in all of its qualities, in everything of what it could mean, in all jobs, in all qualifications, whatever you can think of, the future is sitting here right now. and the future is possibly at home. The future is possibly somewhere else. A question should be asked, where is that future sitting to begin with? However, this is a very important subject for us to focus on, inshallah. And what is our responsibility collectively as a community when it comes to raising the youth? Is it a shared responsibility? Does this responsibility lie alone on the parents? Do the uncles, the aunties have something to do with it? Does the rest of the community have something to do with it? And this is something that, inshallah, we are hoping to address with the blessings of the barakat of Umm al-Baneen and with the blessings of salawat ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. The very first stage to upbringing is marriage. And I'm going to take it back one more step. The very first stage to upbringing is choosing a partner. The very first stage. I'm not going to talk about when the child comes, then this, and no. The very first stage is choosing the right partner. And that partner, instead of calling them a spouse, instead of calling them a husband, a wife, let's call them a life partner. A person who becomes what we say in Arabic, a shariq. They become a partner in the daily affairs. They become a partner in teaching. They become a partner in bringing up children. They become a partner in everything that this word means. Marriage, what we need to understand it to be, it is more than two people coming together with a sheikh or sayyid performing a aqd ceremony, and then they have a party, and then they go back home, and that's it. No, marriage is much bigger than that. Look at the marriage of Ali ibn Abi Talib with Fatima al-Zahra. Look at how Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam, describes their marriage. Look at how he describes their marriage to be a friendship. When he sits by that grave of Fatima al-Zahra, do you know what he says? A wife has just passed away. Recently, Rasulullah has passed away. His heart was broken. It was shattered into pieces. He sits by that grave. He says, "Nafsi ala zafaratiha mahbusatun." My soul is trapped upon its zafarat. The zafarat, a zafra, is the sound a person makes upon the time when the soul is being taken out of the body. That is what a zafra means. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, my soul is trapped upon that, what? Zafarat, upon that sound. Laytaha kharajat ma'a zafarati. I wish that my soul had departed while it was making that sound. Then what does he say? Wa inna iftiqadi Fatimun ba'da Ahmadin. And surely, losing Fatima after Ahmad, dalilun ala an la yaduma khalilu. Evidence that no friendship shall last. Do we see the beauty of how Amir al-Mu'mineen used to look at Fatima al-Zahra? إِنَّ افْتِقَادِي فَاطِمٌ بَعْدَ أَحْمَدٍ دَلِيلٌ عَلَىٰ أَنْ لَا يَدُومَ خَلِيلٌ. And this is the type of relationship between two spouses. Why? Because it becomes a friendship. It becomes a partnership. They have one goal in raising the children together. Marriage in itself, although it is not our topic today, I do want to mention a few points on it. That marriage in itself is something of high benefit to the community, of high benefit to the individuals. It is healthy from a physical point of view, from a mental point of view. It is safety for the husband and the wife. It is safety for the community. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi وآله وسلم محمد لذكره الصلوات has many narrations in which he urges people to get married. The most famous of which that many of us have memorized is the one who gets married has completed half of their religion. Many times we don't finish the other half. The other half is فليتق الله في النصف الآخر. Let them be conscious in the other half. Yes, half of your religion is completed through marriage because of the responsibility it gives you. Half your religion is completed because of what it makes you realize of taqwa, of the haram and forbidden acts it makes you stay away from. However, the other half, فَلْيَتَّقِ اللَّهِ فِي النُّصْفِ الْآخَرِ. However, once again, the Prophet is urging the people to get married. And then it is quite sad to see that in the community struggle that we have today, that marriage becomes hard and more difficult year after year. This is a true calamity. Because we said safety, marriage is safety for the individuals. You know, the Quran is beautiful in its wording. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا لِتَسْكُنُوا comes from the word سَكِينَة. سَكِينَة means calmness. So imagine, the Quran is saying this, one of the philosophies of marriage is that you will feel a sense of calmness with your spouse. Not only that, in turn it causes safety for the community. If we are making it hard, what are we doing? We are causing unsafety. We are definitely causing unsafety. You look at marriage, for example, and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And he comes forward and he says, if a youth comes forward to propose, and you are happy with their akhlaq, their morals, and their religion, wadineh, and their religion, fazawijuh. He didn't say, لو أتاكم رجلا, if a man comes, لو أتاكم شاب. Let's be very careful with the wording here. لو أتاكم شاب, if a youth comes to you, not a man, a youth, whom you are happy with their akhlaq, their moral conduct, you are happy with their religion, فزوجوه, marry them. Then you find the other struggle of mahar as an example. Why does it have to be so high? The famous excuse that we hear for it is because it is safety for my daughter. Mahar is not an insurance payout. Let's be very clear about that. Mahar is not an insurance payout. That in the case they divorce, it is safety for my daughter so that... Let's hold on a second. Why is there talk of divorce to begin with? The aqd isn't even being done yet. And there's already talk of divorce. This takes away from the sakina of marriage. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. The beauty of that marriage takes it away. Furthermore, why is it that the expectations would become higher and higher? The Prophet didn't talk about it. The Prophet didn't say if a person has a house and has this much to give for mahar and has this much to do for what and has a business and on top of that they earn this much, then marry them. No, khuluq and deen. Religion and what? And moral conduct. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi afdalu salati wa salam, he has a beautiful narration in which he says that it is not only on that side, from the other side too, from the father's perspective, for example, from the father of the son, he says that if a son wants to get married and has the need to get married, and the father is able to fulfill that need and he does not, then a forbidden act occurs because of that. فَالْإِثْمُ مُشْتَرَكُ. The father receives, let's say, 50% of the haram deeds, of the deeds that that young man has received. So constant importance. Hold on a second. Safety. Safety. We need money. We need that. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Create this marriage. Allow this marriage to be fulfilled. If they are poor, if they are not wealthy, يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ from what? مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Allah will enrich them from His bounties. Allah didn't say, I will enrich them with money. No, with bounties. And what is greater than the bounties of Allah Azza wa Jal for a person to be enriched with? What is more beautiful? And this is a promise from the Quran. What we need to realize is once we understand that the Quran in itself is the word of Allah Azza wa Jal, do we believe Allah will go against His promise? Yes or no? No. The promise in the Quran is that Allah will enrich them from His bounties. Likewise, for example, you find many promises in the Quran. One, for example, at a time when people were scared to conceive children. Why? Because they are poor. Allah Azza wa Jal replied with a promise in the Quran. Allah yarzuquhum wa iyyakum. Allah will give them rizq, sustenance, and He will also give you rizq, sustenance. A promise from Allah Azza wa Jal. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, beautiful narration. He says that sustenance, there are two doors of sustenance. One of them is the wife and the other is the children. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He says, the narration says that a young man comes to the Holy Prophet and he says to him, O Rasulullah, I am very poor. The Holy Prophet says to him, are you married? He said, no. He said, tazawwaj. Go and marry. Find a wife, get married. By the way, when these narrations are narrated, it isn't a matter of stories that we hear. No, it's application, but I don't want to get into modern stories. It's application, by the way. Many of us and many of the elder members, especially sitting in the community, would have seen the application of these stories even today. Go and ask the elders of this community and you will see that how many youth actually took this path with complete tawakkul upon Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah opened all of these doors for them. So this is the importance. Anyway, so choosing that partner is of high importance. Here, a person will need help from the family, help from the community, in the sense that they should make it easy for them. And they need to understand that they together will be sharing a shared responsibility. I have been asked by the brothers from Haraka Al-Hussainiya to perform a qiyam, inshallah. If you can all step forward to the mambar, there's some space on the left as well. Rahimallah man dhakara al-qa'im min Ali Muhammad. Jazakumullah khair. Make some space for the brothers who are coming in from the back. There's plenty of space on the left, brothers. Plenty of space. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. Jazakumullah khair. And just while everyone else settles down, another salawat, inshallah. So then the husband and the wife need to realize that they have a shared responsibility. And we mentioned this narration yesterday, and I said that I will focus a bit more on it today. The narration is from our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Where he says, الرجل راع على أهله وهو مسؤول عنهم. A man is in charge of his family and he is in charge of their affairs. والمرأة مسؤول عن أهل بيت بعلها وولده. And a woman is also in charge of the household of her husband and the children. أَلَا كُلُّكُمْ رَاعْ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. You are all shepherds and you are all in charge of your flock. So first, the Prophet was saying there is a specific responsibility for the man, and that is the family. Then he gave the exact same responsibility to the woman, and that was her family, the same family. And then he said, "Ala kullukum ra." In fact, all of you, the whole community, are shepherds, and you are all in charge of your flock. See here you can make a difference for. See here you can make a change for. See here you can help. You are in charge of them. You will be held accountable for their actions. And this is why it is important, once we understand that we have this shared responsibility, that teaching must start from that young age on the same wavelength. And this is something very important. How many times do we find that when it comes to the choice of the spouse, that they are on two different wavelengths, maybe two different religions, maybe two different aqaids, maybe two... And this is why it is important for us to understand that when I come to choose my partner, and that partner, I recognize them as the first teacher. For example, in the case of a man, if he is choosing a wife, the man needs to recognize that that wife will be the first teacher to his children. The first teacher to his children. That wife will be the one who will be feeding his children from the breast milk. And we have many narrations about how through the breast milk, Allah Azza wa Jal allows the children to feed from the morals of the mother. We need to recognize that. Are we happy for that to be the case when we come to the choice? Likewise for the woman. We need to recognize that that man will be the first role model for those children. Are you happy with the way this man is? Is this the perfect role model for the children? Once we understand that they are both the first teachers, then we come and we have made the choice, then we come to educating them from a very young age. And this education needs to cover a wide range of subjects, the first of which is a religion. When it comes to fiqh, jurisprudence, aqaid, akhlaq, you see many of these things I've seen in experience. They go to Saturday school, they learn all of these things. They go to this school, they learn all of these things. No. Fiqh starts from the home. Aqaid starts from the home. Akhlaq starts from the home. Fiqh starts with every day-to-day action. The moment there is a najasa, for example, on a table, it is the parents' responsibility to teach their children how to make this table tahir, how to purify that table. The moment najasa falls on the carpet, it is the parents' responsibility to teach the children how to purify the carpet. The parents' responsibility to teach them how to pray, how to perform wudu. Aqaid, the parents' responsibility to teach them tawheed, to teach them nubuwah, teach them imamah, teach them adala, teach them ma'ad. The parents' responsibility. Moral conduct is the parents' responsibility from a very young age. How many times do we see that children, as they grow up, they copy what they see from their parents? This is all part of how we raise our children. Moral conduct. Keeping up with schoolwork. School isn't one of those things where we drop them off, then we take them back home. What did you study? What did you learn today? And this is also where we need to be careful not to be shy to address subjects. If I know that there are specific subjects being addressed at school, I need to make sure that I prepare my children for these subjects. Me signing a petition isn't going to change the fact that my child is going to listen to those words that same day in school. Have I prepared my child for those words? Have I prepared my child enough to the extent where they can distinguish right from wrong and at any age? Yes, from the age of 4, we said on the first night, if you remember when we were talking about identity, we said that the age in which children start to explore their true identity, they start to ask questions, they start to want to know more about themselves is from the age of 4, which is why you find that many institutions have used that age to make sure that they propagate a specific agenda. And likewise, it is the parents' responsibility and the community's responsibility, kullukum ra', to make sure that we teach them to be able to distinguish right from wrong. Why is it that when it comes to other subjects like Darwin's theory, we have no khalas adi ta'al, Darwin's theory, I can talk to you about it today, tomorrow, the day after, and for a whole year I will talk to you about Darwin's theory. But other subjects? No, it's not time for it now. Ba'den, later. Baba, mama, I heard this at school. Yeah, and what did the teacher say? This. Okay, no problem, we'll address it later. This isn't the way to act. We need to be not shy. لا حياء في الدين. In religion, and at the end of the day, we said this is the future, yes? What are the foundations that are being built? Another thing is emotional support. How many times do we find in our community that emotional support is neglected in our families? Emotional support. Let's teach our children from a very young age to be able to express their feelings. You might ask, how is that? The ways are very simple, and many community members I know of have actually applied this way, which is a simple, from when they first start to talk, how are you feeling? When they cry, why is it that you are sad? What made you cry? Allow them to talk. Yes, at the start it becomes hard to express themselves. But train them to be able to express themselves. This is all part of emotional support. Anyway, so we need to set that foundation for the children. And the importance of such a foundation cannot be underestimated. Because the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he has a beautiful narration in which he says, learning at a young age is like engraving on stone. And learning at an old age is like writing on water. When you engrave on stone, it is fixed. It is hard to change. At an old age, writing on water, it flows away. It's gone. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib has a beautiful narration in which he likens the heart of a child to an empty plot of land. An empty plot of land. And that empty plot of land that is ready to accept whatever you want to plant in it. That is the heart of the child. And therefore, it is very important that we focus on their upbringing from the very first day. You see, the ayah that we started with, from Surah Taha, ayah number 132, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Order your family, talking to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. Order your family to establish prayer. وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. And be patient thereon. Now you might tell me, Ibrahim, I speak Arabic. I know the word for sabr is not istabr. For patience is not istabr, it's sabr. Istabr is an extreme type of patience. It's an exaggeration on patience. So yes, it will be difficult. Raising them according to the Islamic values will be difficult. No one said it isn't. The Quran said it will be. Allah Azza wa Jal told his prophet that it will be. Which is why he said, istabr alayha. However, it all starts from the environment that we give them. And that environment starts from when they are born. How many times are we happy when our child, for example, memorizes a specific nursery rhyme or memorizes or learns a specific dance? Look at what my child has learned. Is this the environment that we want to set them in? When is the last time that we played the words of the Holy Quran around our children? When is the last time that we played Ziyarat Ashura in the presence of our children? And by the way, these words, they have a big effect. One thing that we don't realize is that words in general have an effect on the inside without realizing. And I'll give you an example. You see, if someone comes to you and he wants to, for example, swear and shout, what does it do to a man? You start going red, your face has changed. Anger, this happens to the sugar levels, this happens to this, and this happens to that, and the stress levels this. So it's changed what's inside, right? So how would you imagine the words of the Quran that is full of shifa, according to the Quran, what effect that has on the inside of a human? Let's just ponder about that. Maybe we can't see it in the same way we see redness or other things, no. But imagine what kind of effect that has on the inside. The words of the Quran, the words of Ziyarat Ashura, and other things. The environment that I raised them in, bringing them to majalis, allowing this to feel like home to them. Maybe one day when they start to grow up, and for whatever reason that life throws at them, they start to divert away from majalis. When they come back to the majlis, they feel some sort of home feeling. Yes, this feels like home. This is what I grew up on. This is all part of raising the children. That brings us to another responsibility by other community members. When the children are arriving in majalis, let's welcome them with a smile. Let's welcome them with open arms and open hearts. These are all different things that a child, although we don't realize it, it is something that is registered here. And what we need to understand is that a child cannot always be treated as a child. I know they might be 4, 5, 6, 7 years old. However, we find in many narrations where our infallibles would treat children as if they are adults, in the sense that they make them feel a sense of responsibility. They would talk to them to allow them to feel as if they are a person who has an opinion within the family. And there are many examples in this manner. Therefore, it is very important for us as a community, collectively, make sure that we are setting the right examples. Because a community member, and how many times have we seen this as well? A community member growing up, seeing specific individuals as role models, and then seeing acts happening in the future from those same individuals that they saw as role models, and how many times has that caused them to leave religion and go away from religion? How many times? And this is why it is important for us to understand. And I said yesterday, and I warned everyone yesterday, that I use this hadith a lot because it's a beautiful hadith from Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Inshallah, we can all memorize it by the end of these 10 nights. Inshallah, kunu zaynan lana, wala takunu shaynan علينا أحسنتم. Be a decoration to us. Be not a bad image to us. كونوا دعاة لنا بغير ألسنتكم. Call out towards us without your tongues. Many times we use this narration in regards to performing da'wah to other individuals from other sects. No, you are also performing da'wah to the young children. And this applies to everyone as a community. كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. That child, when they see you on the street, when they see you in the majlis and how you act, are you performing da'wah towards the infallibles? Or in what sense are we performing this da'wah? I need to be mindful of how I act. For example, I have a responsibility that when I come off this mumbar, the way I act, I know for a fact that there will be specific individuals looking at me. I need to make sure that I am a decoration to the infallibles. And not a bad image to the infallibles. And this is the responsibility that we all need to understand. It's a collective responsibility. Moreover, when we raise our children and create an environment, and realize, by the way, when I'm saying environment, I'm not just talking about the home. I'm talking about the public and every single place. I need to make sure that I open and pave a way for Amr bil Ma'roof and Nahi anil Munkar, enjoining good and forbidding evil. That I allow community members to help, and this is a big part, to help raise our children. We said we all have a responsibility in raising children, yes? The parents also need to open up some space for the community members to help. Such that when a child sees an elder, and they have teaching them moral conduct and how to respect the elders, and the elder comes to them and advises them on something, they don't turn around and say to them, who are you talking to? They accept the advice and they take it upon themselves. This is a collective responsibility. I need to prepare an environment that is ready for Sahib al-Zaman. Today Sahib al-Zaman comes knocking. I want to see, what are you doing? What is this community that you have prepared for me? You spent Ramadan 30 days reciting, Allahumma inna narghabu ilayka fi dawlatin karima. Oh Allah, we are asking you for a government in which we do not live in humiliation. What have you prepared for that? A valid question from the Imam or not? And tomorrow, inshallah, we'll be talking about the topic of recognizing the Imam of our time. So now, we look at the lifespan of a child. They start with their parents. Marriage is the first thing. And that is their first teacher. Then they grow up, they go into school, and teachers start to teach them, which is also why we need to be careful of what kind of environment we are putting them in that school. They grow up even more. And once they have grown up, they are now making their own life decisions. They are searching for themselves. And this is something highly recommended by our infallibles, that we should search our religion by ourselves to have tafaqquh bid-deen, jurisprudence, from the jurisprudence aspect, from the aqaid aspect, understand what we believe in. And then after that, they come to the same stage that we started in, which was marriage. Because now they are ready for that as well. And it becomes a cycle. Then everything that they learn, they start to share. Zakatul ilmi nashruh. The charity, everything has a charity, the narration says. Everything has a charity. And the charity of knowledge is to share the knowledge. Zakatul ilmi nashruh. So now that they have done that, they start to go further into studying and learning more and educating themselves more. And it becomes a lifespan and it goes. Now you might come and ask me, Ibrahim, you've spoken to us now for about half an hour about raising children collectively as a community, that we all have a shared responsibility. كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. We need to create an environment that is ready for them. Where are you getting all of this from? Valid question. And let me assure you, this is not from my side pocket, as they say. When you look at the seerah of Ali ibn Abi Talib and how he dealt with Ummul Baneen, Salamullah alayha, you see these exact steps established. And for their remembrance, a salawat. You see, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the very first step that he took was choosing the right partner. So now everything is going to start. The puzzle will be completed, inshallah. The very first step he took was choosing the right partner. He went to his brother Aqil and he said to him, Ya Aqil, kharli mara'a waladatha al-fuhul min al-arab. Choose for me a wife that has specific characteristics. That was the first step. Remember the first step, choosing the right spouse, because they will be the first teacher. The second step is to be involved in the raising of the children. Understand that it's a collective responsibility. And you find Amir al-Mu'min Ali ibn Abi Talib, who is a Khalifa, who is an Imam, who has the responsibility of every single Muslim. Look at how he treats his children. He was involved in their everyday today teachings, by the way. Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam has a narration in which he says, لَقَدْ زُقَّ وَلَدِيَ الْعَبَّاسَ الْعِلْمَ زَقَّى. My son Abbas, Zaq in the Arabic language is the beak of a bird. When the mother feeds the bird in the beak, that is called Zaq. So Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying that knowledge has been transferred to my son Abbas in the same way a mother feeds its duckling from its beak. The same manner. Zaqqa waladi al-Abbas al-ilma zaqqa. Around the correct environment, around Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein, and others. Rahimallah, Ammi al-Abbas, Imam al-Sadiq says, لَقَدْ كَانَ نَافِذَ الْبَصِيرَةِ. He had clear insight. And inshallah, we'll focus on the topic of insight and basira on the night of Abul Fadl al-Abbas, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to. And we can look at the knowledge aspect of Abul Fadl al-Abbas. This is all with what? With the teachings of Amir al-Mu'mineen, choosing the right environment. Amir al-Mu'mineen, on one occasion, he brings Abul Fadl al-Abbas to him. He sits him down and he sits Lady Zainab next to him. So now it's become what? Bringing the children together and teaching them together. He says, Ya Abbas, say one. He says to him, one, wahid. He says to him, Ya Abbas, say two. He said, I am embarrassed to mention two with the same tongue that mentioned one, for Allah is one. This is the tarbiyah, the upbringing of who? Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi afdhalus salati was salam. This is how he would raise his children. Then you find the third and final step, the collective part of the community, is how you found that Ummul Baneen and the choice of that perfect family and the choice of raising him in the correct environment and the right community allowed him to come to a point where he had complete understanding of Tawheed, of Imama, of Nubuwa. You find that when it comes to the issue of Tawheed on the day of Ashura, what does he say? When he comes to the river and he wants to drink from that cold water, he says, Ya nafsu min ba'd al-Husayni huni. O self, do not humiliate yourself before Hussein. فَبَعْدَهُ لَا كُنْتِ أَن تَكُونِي. After him, you are nothing to be. هَذَا حُسَيْنٌ وَارِدُ الْمَنُونِ. This is Hussein approaching death. وَتَشْرَبِينَ بَارِدَ الْمَعِينِ. While you want to drink from the cold water, تَاللَّهِ مَا هَذَا فِعَالُ دِينِ. By Allah, this is not the acts of my religion. Understanding religion. Nubuwa, Imama, she taught them that this is your way to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that is why through those teachings, she taught them sacrifice. Knowing that this is the way to Allah Azza wa Jal, four sons she gave for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. Which is why you find that when the caravan returns to the city of Medina, Imam Zainul Abideen looks at a man by the name of Bishr ibn Hadlam. He says to him, Ya Bishr, رحم الله أباك, إنه كان شاعرا. May Allah have mercy upon your father. He was a poet. Are you able to do some of the same? He said to him, My master, I am a poet too. He said, In that case, then enter Medina and mourn Hussein. Bishr ibn Hadlam would enter Medina. He would shout with the loudest of his voice, Ya أهل يثرب الآم قائم لكم بها. O people of Medina, you have no place in it anymore. Everyone gathers around Bishr ibn Hadlam. Bishr, tell us what has happened. Why is it that you are saying, Ya Ahla Yathrib la muqama lakum biha? Why is it that we have no place in it anymore? He says to them, meet me by the Masjid of Rasulullah, Ajarakumullah. He carries on to go around Medina, through the streets of Medina, through its alleyways, shouting, Ya Ahla Yathrib, La Muqam Lakum Biha, Ya Ahla Yathrib, La Muqam Lakum Biha. Until he reaches the Masjid of Rasulullah, everyone has gathered. They say to him, Oh Bishr, what is the news? At that point, he would say, Ya Ahla Yathrib la muqam lakum biha, ya qutl al-Hussain. Fa'admu'i midra'aru al-jismu minhu bi-karbala mudarrajun. Wal-ra'su minhu ala al-qanat yuda'aru. Oh, people of Medina, you have no place in it anymore. Hussein has been killed, therefore I am shedding my tears. His body in the land of Karbala has been left imbued, and his head is being taken from place to place on a spear. Ajarakum Allah, Bishr ibn Hadlam would narrate that I did not leave a single person in Medina except that they felt it was like the day that Rasulullah had passed away. And there wasn't a single woman in Medina except that she would leave her house slapping her head, shouting, Wa Husayna, Wa Husayna. Then I looked between the crowd and I saw a woman approaching me, holding an infant to her shoulder, saying, make way for him to tell us the news. والله صاحت صاحت يا ناس بالله دف رجولة دف رجولة أو خلوه ينزل عن ذلولة بسايلة بسايلة واستمع قال يا أم التقى وذوله بذولة والله عباس عباس راع الزود يولة. She arrives by Bishr ibn Hadlam. He says, I did not recognize this woman. I looked at a man sitting by my side. I said to him, who is this woman? He said to me, وَيْحَكَ يَا بِشْرُ إِنَّهَا أُمُّ الْبَنِينَ. We're upon you, O Bishr. This is Ummu al-Banin, the mother of Abbas and his brothers. He said, at this point, I knew that when she asked me who I am mourning is because she is in shock. So I didn't want to give her the news straight away. So I said to her, oh, Ummu al-Banin, my condolences go to you for your son, Jafar. She said, I didn't ask about Jafar. He would say, my condolences go to you for your son Uthman. She would say to him, tell me about Hussein. He said, my condolences go to you for your son Abdullah. She said to him, tell me about Hussein. Is he dead or alive? At that point, he would say to her, Ya Umm al-Banin, my condolences go to you for your son Abbas. He was left by the river with no hands. Oh, Umm al-Banin, sit down and cry away. If you want the news, then hear what I have to say. Three of your sons in Karbala they lay, and Abbas, both his head and hands were cut off. She would take a breath and sigh, if you think for my sons I cry, to Karbala I send them to die. Just tell me Hussein is safe. قلها يا سائل يا سائل يا اللي تنشدين
تنشدين إن شأن تردين الخبر زين تقعدي وهلي دمعة العين لك أربعة بالطف مطاعين تقول له والله لو تنفنى سبع الأراضين وافقد مثل عباس سبعين والله بس عالم يظل رأس يا سلي حسين هاجركم الله وبليفرز ذنريشن ودمنشن ذات وان ينفومد اوفر العباس هبك ودأش ذا انفنت ودفول اون ذا فلو ذات انفنت واز عبيد الله ذا سن اوف العباس هي ودفول اون ذا فلو شي ود سي تيم ويحك لقد قطعتني يا
I'm الفجار بعد ربت لك يا حسين والله بعد ربت لك يا حسين وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين.
أجري بارك الله فيكم. Please rise in honor of أم البنين عليه السلام. بعد الحوائج, she is the daughter of our niece. So don't deprive yourself. Above all, don't deprive yourself of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and don't deprive yourself from receiving the blessings of Umm al-Baneen insha'Allah, this life and the shafa'a of Umm al-Baneen insha'Allah. In the hereafter, let me hear your voices for Umm al-Baneen.
ما شاء الله يا حسين وين صايب
شوي نزل اليوم
باي وزين ابتي وين ويتنا يا ايدي زين ابتي وين ويتنا يا ايدي هايا
Where's your voices? Where's your voices? اللي يحب يشارك ما شاء الله
زين ابتي وين ويتنا يا ايدي
شويه فوليوم سيد
باي وخويا وياي روحي لها يا ايدي
I can see closed mouths. Boys, let me hear your voice.
يا نبتي وين وقتنا ايدي
صوتك ما شاء الله
باي ويا حسين يا عيل ذيك شرايك بطار في لساني هاي باي وحاشاك ليل يوم الوعد تنساني بوزين ابتي وين ويتنا يا ايدي بوخويا وياي روحي لها يا ايدي ها
Let me get your attention for just a couple of minutes as I describe The poem that inshallah will recite for you. Yes, Umm al-Baneen alayhi salam is a mother who has pride. Yes, Umm al-Baneen alayhi salam is a mother that has pride. But tonight, as the Shaykh mentioned in his lecture towards the end, there is a special reunion between Umm al-Baneen and Abul Fadl al-Abbas. And every single year we hear of this reunion in the maqatil, in the majalis, it always brings a tear to the eye. When Zainab alayhi salam welcomes Umm al-Baneen, the first thing that Umm al-Baneen would say to Sayyida Zainab is wa Husayna. And Sayyida Zainab would say to Umm al-Baneen, wa Abbasa. And so the poem comes and says, Umm al-Baneen has a guest Age decades from all the pain. Zainab cries out for Abbas and she cries out for Hussein. And she cries out for Hussein.
Umm al-Baneen has a guest. Age decades from all the pain. Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. Jami'an, Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. Zainab cries out Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. Zainab cries out for Abbas.
Voices, mashallah.
And she cries out for Hussein. Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. After the dust had settled, the men all buried and gone. After the dust had settled, the men all buried and gone, Zainab raised Abbas's. Zainab raised Abbas's flag and told the girls, carry on. They reply as they're marching, and they reply as they're marching, Yazid's chains have reached our bone. Yazid's chains have reached our bone. Auntie, it is just too tough. Auntie, it is just too tough to watch Shimir jeer and laugh. Auntie, where is Abbas? She replies, Abbas is gone. You'll never see him again. Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. Zainab is out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. Zainab cries out for, and she cries out. They return to Medina, land of Zahra's broken rib. The poet calls the people and cries, O land of Yathrib, they've decimated the house of the father of Zainab, of the father of. Out comes running a woman, old age and her voice broken. Please tell me about my son. He tells her of her children, one by one and name by name. Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein Zainab. You've got louder, and she cries out for Abdallah, mate with the dust. His heart chewed up by arrows, and of your beloved Ja'far, by the Furat his blood flows, Uthmani and the taste of death. How you'll bear only God knows, how you'll bear only God knows. Abbas's hands were severed, Abbas's hands were severed, handless your lion suffered, their thirst left his heart shattered. Her cries awaken the dead, and her tears embarrass him. Zainab, Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Zainab, Zainab cries out for out for Hussein. She cries, Bashir, I beg you. Oh, she cries, Bashir, I beg you. Tell me not of my children. I've given 10,000. To see my beloved return, I'd give 10,000 children to see my beloved return. He replies, end of Hussein. He replies, end of Hussein. All of his ribs were broken. All of his ribs were broken. Once beheaded by Shimr. Once beheaded by Shimr. He was left to lay there bare, his girls watching in despair. Umm al-Baneen strikes her head, from Wales her tongue can't refrain. Zainab, Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she cries out for Hussein. Zainab cries out for Abbas, and she I brought the hands of Abbas, and I brought the hands of Abbas, and I brought Hussein's turban. I brought the hands of Abbas, and I brought Hussein's turban. Let us lament together and fuel this fire within. I saw Abu Fadhil fall, I saw Abu Fadhil fall. I saw Hussein's last moments. The crying will never end. The crying will never end. To lament, angels descend. This grief too few comprehend. They throw Hussein's blood upward. Yes, they throw Hussein's blood upward. Return it toward his veins. Return it toward his veins. Zainab, Zainab cries out for Abbas. And she cries out for Zainab, Zainab cries out for Abbas.
Rise out for Hussein. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah wa ala al-arwah allati halat bifinaik. عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين خصوصا سيدي ومولاي أبي الفضل العباس واخته زينب جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته إلهي بمريض كربلاء زين العابدين يا رب عافي وشافي جميع المرضى على خص من أوصانا بالدعاء يا الله اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك جنبنا معاصيك اجعل عواقب أمورنا خيرا يا الله إلهي بالحسين تقبل منا من مؤسسي هذا المجلس بأحسن قبول يا الله اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من أنصاره وأوانه ومن الذابين عنه من المستشهدين بين يدي يا الله وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات وأرواح خدمة الحسين نهدي لهم ثواب سورة المباركة الفاتحة مسبوقة بالصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.
أحسنت ملا طيب الله أنفاس.